Welcome to Nature at Doorstep. In today's video, we are going to see about honeybees. Have you ever wondered how bees communicate with each other and in what language they communicate? I'm sure many of you might be thinking this. Why is every single cell in a beehive hexagonal in shape? And why is it not in other geometrical shapes? And how are these honeybees making honey? We are going to see the answer for all these three questions in detail in this video. But before that, if you are viewing my channel for the very first time, please do like, share and subscribe. And don't forget to click the bell icon for getting the notifications on my upcoming videos. How do bees communicate with each other? Bees actually dance to communicate. Yes, you heard it right. They actually dance. And in fact, every single move in their dance has got some meaning. And this dance is called the waggle dance under the concept of swarm intelligence. It's a complete big topic in engineering field. Let's not get more detail into it. But to understand better, I want you to know little bit about the type of bees and their nature. There can be only one queen to a particular beehive. And the queen is the presiding head for the entire beehive. And apart from that, her duty also involves laying eggs to increase a bee family population. You can easily identify a queen bee among other bees by looking at her size. She is long, elongated, and she is always surrounded by worker bees, and she is never left alone. And coming to drones, drones are the male bees, and their main duty is to assist the queen in reproduction. And these drones are a little bit broader in size compared to queen and worker bees. And they don't have mandibles. And only with the help of a mandible, a bee can actually chew its food. Now you can ask me, if a male bee is not having a mandible, then how it is surviving without having its food? And to know the answer, keep watching the video till the end. And finally, the worker bees. These are non-productive females. And the duty involves housekeeping, feeding queen, feeding drones, feeding larva, collecting pollen, collecting nectar, making wax, making honey. In fact, each and every single work that has to be done inside a beehive is done one and only by these worker bees. And coming back to the mode of communication, that is the waggle dance. A set of bees actually move out from their hive in search of food. And these set of bees are called the forager bees. Once they find a large amount of pollen and nectar in a place, they try to absorb as much nectar as possible. And you know something? These honeybees, they have got two different stomachs. One is their digestive stomach and the other is the honey stomach. The nectar that they are absorbing gets deposited in the honey stomach. And they try to collect as much pollen as possible. Nectar is the main source of energy and it also contains the water content required for the honeybee to survive. And pollens are the main source of protein. So the honeybees collect these two and the moment they feel that their honey stomach is full with nectar, then they return back to their beehive. And after returning back, they try to share the collected nectar with the housekeeping honeybees as well as to the second set of foraging bees. After meal, what next? It's party time! The dance floor is all set to rock. Now, the honeybee that returned with the nectar will start dancing in the dance floor. And all the remaining honeybees that tasted the nectar from this particular honeybee will become the audience for this particular honeybee. If you look closely and concentrate, even you can identify what these bees are trying to communicate. For example, if they do a round dance, it means that the food is somewhere very near to their hive, say less than 100 meters. And if they do a waggle dance, it means their food is a bit far away from their hive. And in waggle dance, they clearly try to convey in which particular direction their food is available relative to the position of sun. And how much energy is required for them to reach that particular place based on its waggle speed and how far it is from their hive. All the details they clearly try to express through their moves. And now you can ask me, so many forager bees would have come back. And so many bees would be dancing simultaneously. Then how will the second set of forager bee decide which particular bee to follow? I mean, which particular dance to look for? And for that, they use a very simple technique. The bee that is dancing, in between its dance, it will start spraying the nectar from its honey stomach. And whomsoever tastes the nectar will decide whose nectar is the sweetest, and accordingly they'll start following that particular honeybee's dance moves. And this spraying of nectar doesn't happen just once. It happens n number of times to indicate that there is surplus amount of food available if they follow the dance moves of this particular honeybee and reach that place. And after receiving the necessary information from the dance moves, the second set of forager bee will now leave the hive in that particular direction in search of pollen and nectar. While the second set of forager bees are out in search of food, the housekeeping honeybees will start the process of making honey. Honey making is actually an interesting topic. The house bee that received the nectar from the forager bee will now try to transfer the collected nectar to other housekeeping honeybees which has not tasted the nectar. They'll see to it that all the housekeeping honeybees receive the nectar. And nectar is a combination of water and sugary substance. All the honeybees that receive the nectar will try to absorb the water for their survival, and they try to break down the sugar in the nectar with the enzyme that they produce in the stomach. And now you can ask me, why do they want to break down the sugar content in nectar? And that's because sugar content in nectar is complex in nature. And these complex sugars are easily prone to crystallization. That's why honeybees produce an enzyme in their stomach for breaking down this complex sugar into simple sugars, which are less prone to crystallization. And once they feel that they have fully converted the complex sugars into simple sugars and the water content in the nectar has also reduced down to 20%, then the honey is ready for storing in the beehive. Every single honeybee will now try to transfer the fully converted nectar into the cell of the honeycomb. And now, after transferring the fully converted nectar, they'll start with the fanning process. Fanning is done to maintain the temperature inside the hive and also to evaporate any excess water from the stored nectar. And when the honey cell is full with honey, and when the honey meets the requirement, to prevent further evaporation and to prevent dripping of honey, they cover the honey cell with beeswax. You can ask me, from where do they get beeswax to cover the honey cell? They don't actually get, they actually make their own beeswax. After a certain age, glands on the underside of worker bee bellies secrete a substance called wax flakes. With the help of their hind legs, they take it to their mouth, and with the help of mandibles, they start chewing this wax flakes to a point till the wax becomes soft and moldable. And once this wax becomes moldable, they use this wax for honeycomb construction and also for sealing the honey cells. I hope now you would have understood how bees communicate with each other, how honey is formed, and how they produce this beeswax. All this is fine. But can you brief us a little more about why few cells are capped and few cells are not capped? And about the color variations inside the honeycomb? Yeah, definitely. The capped cells that you see here are actually the honey cells that are filled with honey. And during peak winters, when they are running short of food, they actually start chewing the beeswax capping and start taking the honey for their survival. And next comes the shiny wet nectar cells, that is the uncapped honey cells. These cells are left open because the honey in it still has got some moisture content left. Only when the moisture content in all these cells evaporate and when the honey meets standard, the honeybees will cap these cells. And now comes the pollen. Pollen cells you can easily identify by looking at its color. They'll be mild yellow to sunshine yellow. And these pollen are the main source of protein. And they will always be placed near to the larva cells so that it will be easy for the worker bees to feed the larva. And when it comes to larva cells, you can see the larva cells all white in color. Queen bee, before laying her egg, she checks the brood cells. If the brood cell is not clean, she doesn't lay her egg in that particular brood cell. And she moves to the next cell. And also, depending on the size of the cell, she lays her eggs accordingly. A smaller cell is for the worker bee and bigger cells are for the drone. As said before, drones are slightly bigger in size compared to the worker bees, and so is the cell size. And queen cells are very easy to find out. It will be larger then the size of a drone cell and a worker cell and the shape will again be very different. And once the queen had laid her egg, it is the duty of the worker bee to take care of the larva. Worker bees feed the larva with pollen and honey. And once they feel the larva is about to mature, then they close the cell with a papery kind of a substance which has got minute air pockets. The worker larva cells will be closed flat, whereas the drone larva cells will be closed in the form of a dome shaped. And this difference in capping of cells is mainly for the worker bees to identify between a drone larva and a worker larva cell. The worker larva, once it matures, it has to tear the papery substance capping its cell on its own. No help will be extended. In fact, even after coming out of the brood cell, this young worker bee has to clean its cell on its own. Whereas, when the male drone larva matures, the worker bees tear the papery substance capping the drone larva cell and help the young drone bee to come out of its cell. And once the drone bee is out of its cell, the worker bees will start cleaning its cell. A question continuously kept striking me. Why are male bees alone pampered so much? Whereas, female worker bees alone are made to do so much task and not even a single help is extended to them. Why is this discrimination between a male and a female? Somehow, I was not convinced at all. And then I did a lot of research only to find out that drones doesn't have a mandible. And for doing all this work, starting from cleaning their cell, for feeding themselves, and even for tearing the papery substance to let the young drones come out, they need the mandible. I hope now you would have understood why males are being fed for their survival. And finally, coming to the six-sided shapes, which is so prevalent in nature. Have you ever wondered how are bees able to construct such perfect geometric masterpieces? And why have they chosen hexagon shape alone and not any other geometrical shape? You know, our scientists, after doing years and years of research, have concluded that hexagon is the most efficient shape among other geometrical shapes. And you know why? Wax making is actually a very tedious task for the honeybees. You know, for producing just 1 kilo of wax, they have to absorb nearly 8 kilo of honey. And for filling their honey stomach once, they have to visit nearly 100 flowers. So just imagine how much work is involved behind in the process of making honey. And what if they're going to use the entire honey for making wax? It is not efficient, right? Thinking about all this, the bees have done a complete trial and error with all possible geometrical shapes. And finally, they have come down to this hexagonal shape, wherein they require just minimal wax to fix the patterns together, and at the same time, they get lot of strength under compression. Come, I'll tell you how. As in the first case, when the bees initially thought of constructing their cells in circles, they found the circles are not closely packed. There is some empty space left in between the cells for which they had to produce more wax to fill those empty spaces. And bees felt that these empty spaces they are not going to use at all. And unnecessarily, just for keeping the cells intact, they are producing this additional extra wax, which is not efficient for them at all. And so they decided to quit the circular model and moved on to trying with the next geometrical shape, that is the square. When it comes to square, though the bees felt the cells are closely packed, they felt that they are producing more wax to keep the cells intact compared to the hexagonal shape. And that's because hexagonal packing actually minimizes the perimeter for a given area because of its geometrical pattern. That is, if you want to fill a large space with geometrical pattern of identical shape of same area with minimal boundary, then hexagon is the best option. Not only that, and mechanically it is considered one of the strongest design since it can gain strength under compression. I hope now you would have understood as to why nature has chosen hexagon as one of the most efficient design. I hope the video was interesting. If you have any doubts or if you have any queries that need to be cleared, please do post your queries in the comment section. And if you find the video useful, please do like, share and subscribe. And don't forget to click the bell icon for getting the notifications on my upcoming videos. Thank you.